Hi, Julia.
Hi, Ben.
Look, I thought we could spend a few moments discussing timing in 1954 Act ground F cases. Because my feeling is often that parties can be quite passive when it comes to how long proceedings will take to be resolved. But it's actually possible to be quite proactive. Or, in fact, parties don't give enough thought to how fast they want the proceedings to go in the first place.
I think that's exactly right. The first thing you have to do is work out if you want the process to go fast or to go slow. The landlord might really want the process to go fast if it's got genuine redevelopment plans, it's raring to go. It might already have secured vacant possession of the other units, and every day that goes by is holding up the programme, and obviously delaying the improved income and developer's profit.
Well, quite. On the other hand, I often see landlords in the opposite situation where their redevelopment plans are at an incredibly early stage and they need all the time they can get to do what needs to be done to meet the ground F requirements. So they need to refine their plans, cost it, get vacant possession of other units, get planning permission, line up contractors, financing, what have you. So in those circumstances, they want to go slow.
Yeah, of course. And in the meantime, they usually want to prolong the existing rental stream and avoid the empty rate right up to the point the demolition commences. So it's quite a tricky balance. And equally, from a tenant's perspective, you might be quite happy to go slowly as well, because if you can see that the landlord has genuine redevelopment plans that mean you're going to lose your lease, you might not mind. But in the meantime, you want to trade profitably for as long as you can.
Yeah, or again, I mean, there's so many considerations here. On the other hand, you might get your wily, cynical tenants who might want to exploit the landlord's position for tactical gain. So, if a landlord wants to go fast, the tenant wants to drag things out in the hope of securing a payout from the landlord. Or if the landlord wants to go slow, the tenant can try and push ahead with the trial timetable in the hope that the landlord won't be able to establish ground F.
Yeah, and I think on that last point, it's really key to consider what the landlord has to demonstrate and when. And we all know the landlord has to demonstrate its intention to redevelop at the point of trial. But under ground F, the works have to commence on the termination of the current tenancy. So the current tenancy will end 3 months and 21 days after the judgment is given, obviously, unless there's an appeal. But that doesn't mean the landlord has to send the bulldozers in literally the day the tenancy comes to an end. There's also a short period or a reasonable time thereafter. So what that short period is depends on the facts of every case. And there are a handful of cases on how long the period is, but they don't really help us because they're also fact specific. I generally advise my landlord clients that they should be aiming to start their works within 3 months of the judgment. But the more complex the redevelopment, the more moving parts are in play. It's really only a rule of thumb. And obviously, given that the reasonable time depends on the facts, if you're a tenant and you want to go fast, you really should push the landlord hard to explain what progress it's made and is making. And if you do that, you might be able to line up an argument at trial that the landlord shouldn't now have any extra time. It's been slow in the past, it was warned fairly and squarely to get a move on, and it shouldn't now get the indulgence of the court. So I think if you put all that together, the crunch point is going to be sort of 6 months and 21 days after judgment. And that is the point at trial that landlord's got to persuade the judge it's got a reasonable prospect of starting the works.
Okay, right. So that's our target point. Two points that occurred to me. The first, as you said, it's worth remembering that the test is whether the landlord has a reasonable prospect of being able to carry out the works at that target date. The landlord doesn't have to show that it will be able to start the works on the balance of probabilities. It's a lower threshold than that. So we've got to bear that in mind. Secondly, here we go. Here's my old Francis drum. There might be a Francis point buried in here. If the landlord wants to do the works now, but only in order to get the tenant out, and in fact, if the tenant left voluntarily, the landlord would only do the works in, say, a couple of years' time. I think the tenant has a pretty decent Francis argument that the landlord's intention is impermissibly conditional. There you go. I knew I'd squeeze it
Oh, well, I'd expect nothing less from you,
in.
Ben. I mean, I think just thinking about some of the nuts and bolts of actually running the case. I mean, the first thing to think about when it comes to getting the claim started if your goal is to go first, the first thing you've got to do is serve your Section 25 or your Section 26 notice or your counter notice as early as you can. And then do the same with the claim. You can issue the claim long before the contractual termination date. In fact, you could issue it the very next day if you wanted to. And in fact, sometimes that's a really good way of demonstrating you mean business.
Yeah. Okay. So claim's been issued. Defence is due in 28 days, but there might be an extension of time agreed, possibly. How long it then takes to get your CMC is entirely down to the court. I mean, I find that Central London can take about 4 months at the moment from the defence, but it's really variable. If you are in Central London, there are standard directions which provide for a PTR about 28 weeks after the CMC. And those directions won't list the matter for trial. The thinking is Central London's just completely inundated and gummed up with 54 Act cases, which all settle. So they won't list for trial until much further down the line. Now, in Central London, that's not a huge problem because the availability of judges at the moment means that trials can be listed really quickly, like 6 weeks after the PTR. But if you're in a different location, you might be able to get a trial listing at the CMC, which might save a bit of time. So that's one option.
And actually, another tip, if you're acting for a landlord and you want things to go fast, you don't have to just passively agree the standard directions that are put forward. So if you think about it, the landlord's the one who's got to do all the heavy lifting on things like disclosure and witness evidence. So if you want to front load that work, you could turn up at the CMC having already gone through standard disclosure. You could have even served your witness statements and maybe be quite close to expert reports. And as long as the tenant has had enough time, gets a fair opportunity to really consider the disclosure and the evidence, there's no need to build in more time for that. And if you can do that, you could shave 10, 12 weeks off your directions to trial.
I mean, we're calling this little chat tips and tricks and tips. That has got to be my favourite one. And I've deployed that really successfully in the past. You can really shave things off. Other possibilities, summary judgments, speed things up. I mean, my experience is that can backfire. Mm. It won't save that much time. It can put all the usual directions to trial on hold. And it really can quite substantially add to landlord's burden. So be cautious with that. Similarly, applications for expedition are really quite tricky because you've got to show why you should jump to the front of the queue of other litigants. And having an otherwise empty building ready to be developed is unlikely to be a good reason. So wrapping all of this up, at least if you're in Central London, you might expect a defence 1 or 2 months after issue, a CMC maybe 4 months after that, a PTR about 6 or 7 months after that, but you might be able to shave that down by up to 3 months if you're the landlord, a trial of about 3 months after that. So that's a trial about 12 to 17 months from issue, with then about another almost 7 months before the works have to start, provided the judgment of the trial isn't reserved. So it's still quite a long period.
And actually, if you go back even further, in total, you could be looking at anywhere from 18 to 24 months from the point you serve the notice up to the point you need to start the development. And there's a lot of opportunities along the way for either party to tweak the timings.
Yeah. So it's a long process, but that doesn't mean you can't try and control it and try and use it to your tactical advantage. Nice to speak.
And you.